to say, if you hate your boomerang so much, altogether, why don't you throw it away? That's all very well in theory. It may seem that simple to you. Why don't you throw your boomerang away? Because I threw it away yesterday too. There are times when life is not easy. There are days when the future looks black. There are days when you throw your boomerang away. There are days when your boomerang comes back. There are times it gets me down. Perhaps I shouldn't let it. What I can't understand is this. How did I ever get it? Sometimes we're in the front garden, I throw it then hurry indoors. And within half an hour there's a ring on the bell and a small boy says, is this yours? Once I got really angry, I taped some dynamite to it. And without really thinking things through, I lit the fuse and I threw it. With hindsight, this was an error. We learn lessons from life. I was taught it is better to think before throwing your boomerang. Never think after you've caught it. I've resorted to desperate measures. Sometimes when I throw the stick, I try to move house before it comes back. But you can't get a mortgage that quick. I had a Jack Russell Terrier once. I used to call him Jack. I used to throw my boomerang for him. The stick used to bring the dog back. I've seen the stickers in car windows and it gets me right here like a knife. A boomerang's not just for Christmas. Altogether, a boomerang is for life. To get on a plane to DC, and there in the realm of the fool at the helm, we would argue the toss, him and me. I would take him to task. Why Iraq, I would ask. Some folk would say that's a crime, so that they, when it's done, have democracy, son. That's not what you said at the time. If I may beg your pardon, it was linked with Bin Laden. It was yellowcake from Niger. It was WMDs, it was all three of these, none of which seemed to be there. You imply that we lie, said George, Tony and I, but he had some not that long ago. I said, you don't care if the weapons are there. He said, care. I said, yeah. He said, no. He's got bombs, germs and gas. No, he's not. Yes, he has. Though we've searched all his country retreats. Rumsfeld shook his hand, we delivered them, and Dick Cheney's still got the receipts. And those we've not killed, we will help them rebuild. It's just work for your friends, George, I said. He said, are you certain? I said, Halliburton. He said nothing but went rather red. You and Tony complained about Saddam Hussein, and I've listened to all that, I said. May I grasp the nettle? The words pot and kettle spring at these times to my head. You've got nukes in bases in dozens of places, anthrax, nerve gases too. What, me? He said, yes. I said, time to confess. He said, me. I said, yes. I said, you. Terrorists too. Haven't you trained a few? He said, who? I said, you. He said, not. Isn't that what you do at Fort Benning? I said. Oh, Fort Benning. Oh, yes. I forgot. Then after a pause, that Saddam added, George, lock folk up and without a trial too. They were tortured as well. You do that. Do I, yeah? He said, me. I said, yes. I said, you. Abu Ghraib, so they say, and Guantanamo Bay. Did you try them all first? No, we can't. That wouldn't make sense. We've got no evidence. We can't find them guilty. They aren't. Due process of law. We don't do that no more. That's no way to protect liberty. Extraordinary rendition is far more efficient. We'll take you. I said, who? I said, me. Yes, you in a plane. I said, who? Come again. He said, you, flying big silver bird. Me and the CIA? Is it my lucky day? He said no, and I quickly concurred. With a bag on my face and the jump leads in place. A man pressed a switch, I said, ooh. He said, do you confess? I said, certainly, yes. He said, splendid, we thought it was you. You people are bad. It's as well that George had a plan for times such as these. We torture for proof. George is lying for truth and his army's gone killing for peace. Freedom's in jail at the end of my tale and the world is still in a mess. Who put us there, Mr. Bush, Mr. Blair? I say you. You say no. I say yes. roll up, cried the ringmaster. See the man on the flying trapeze. The one we've just fitted with plastic. That's him over there in the trees. Where's Cosmo? The fairly accurate knife thrower. The girl with the baby said, her name was Lucille. They knew Cosmo would know her because she still had a knife in her head. He's back there in the procession, said the ringmaster, pointing to an old half-timbered Morris. It's Cosmo, the fairly accurate knife thrower, and his lovely assistant, Doris. Lucille stormed up to him in anger. Gave him the baby. He didn't resist. He was shamed by the memory of the night she conceived. He'd aimed for a sister and missed. Little did she know that the child Cosmo gained on that morning's Morris Traveller ride would become the world-famous stuntman, Evil Schmeevil, and his Yamashita 125. He grew up a child of the circus, rode the Big Dipper, the Dodgems, the Ghost Train, with Cosmo, the fairly accurate knife thrower, and his lovely assistant, Elaine. Once upon a time they kept marine mammals, but every one was a guinea, and now the pool stands empty. There isn't any porpoise in it. Evil set the animals free, because that's what he knew they would wish. You can't keep animals in cages these days, and it never worked that well with the fish. And soon he was a star of the circus, in the Morris Traveller, still travelling on, with Cosmo, the fairly accurate knife thrower, and his lovely assistant, Yvonne. Poor Cosmo was on the decline. He was hitting the Boddington's loopy juice. And in one afternoon, it two lovely assistants, four passers-by and a migrating Canada goose. But his circus was making a fortune, and the audiences willingly paid it to see Evil leap over 36 National Front members and cheer when he never quite made it. And then before they get out of the ring, the next act would kill two or three. It was Cosmo, the fairly accurate knife thrower, and his lovely assistant, Marie. Then the climax of Evil's career was announced with fanfare and fuss. He'd leap over 42 motorbikes in a corporation double-decker bus. It was on the 189 to Stockport that Evil set out after his dream. Drove at 75 miles an hour down Wellington Road North, towards the Little Sisters of the Poor Formation motorbike team. Some say the lady on the back seat stood up, but they found a puncture in the front wheel and a knife inscribed to Cosmo, the fairly accurate knife thrower, from his lovely assistant, Lucy.